Is the Honda S2000 still a good purchase in the year 2020? That's the topic I want to discuss today. And to help me do that, I am currently driving my friend Chris's 2007 AP2 S2000. And those of you who've been following the channel for a while probably already know I've owned three different S2000s, including an AP2, an AP1, and then an AP1 with an AP2 motor. So I pretty much experienced all the different kinds of S2000s. I've driven a supercharged one with 400 horsepower. I've driven a CR, various different track prep models, bone stock AP1s, AP2s. And while I don't own an S2000 anymore, this car still holds a very, very special place in my heart. Over the past few years, the values of these cars have been creeping up pretty steadily. Haggerty actually scores this car a rating of 78 out of 100. That means the S2000 is actually well ahead of the average classic car tracked on Haggerty, which has a score of 50. And according to car gurus, the average price of S2000s across all model years from 2000 to 2009 has been creeping up around 2 to 4% year over year. Last year, there was a very, very low mileage, meaning like less than 1,000 mile AP1 that sold for $49,500. That is over 15 grand more than the original MSRP of the car. Also, according to Haggerty, the number of classic car insurance quotes they've gotten for the S2000 has grown 55% over the previous year. Honda actually did make quite a few S2000s. I don't remember the exact number, but I'll actually show that on the screen. And so what that means is anytime you're browsing Craigslist, AutoTrader, Cars.com, whatever your favorite used car buying site is, you'll actually see a decent number of S2000s for sale. I mean, I know this because I've been tracking these cars for the last 6 to 7 years, and they range anywhere from just under 10 grand for a really beat up or salvage title one to upwards of 35 to 40 grand for a really, really low mileage example or even a club racer edition. So if we assume the average price of the average S2000 on the market right now is somewhere in the $20,000 to $25,000 range, that basically puts the S2000 still in line with like a well-optioned brand new Toyota Corolla, which to the vast majority of people is a pretty affordable and economical car. Now, I'm not saying that anyone is reasonably cross-shopping an S2000 with a new Corolla or something like that, but the point is that the average S2000 is still a relatively affordable car for most people. And although the values are now creeping up because they're on the radar of many classic car collectors now, it's a little bit different than the average classic car in the sense that these cars are still new enough and being Hondas reliable enough to where you don't actually have to spend a whole ton of money on maintenance to keep these cars running on the road. All of the issues are very well documented. They're pretty straightforward to fix, and parts are not yet at the point where they're impossible to find, like for my 91 NSX. These cars hold up really well with mileage. I've seen examples with well over 200,000 miles. In fact, I've driven one with almost 250,000 miles completely stock. And although it probably wasn't making the original 240 horsepower anymore, the car still felt very much like an S2000. It was very, very drivable. So one of the other arguments I hear against the S2000 nowadays is that you're really not getting that much performance for the money. Yes, this car only has 240 horsepower and not very much torque. Then again, the car's pretty light at around 2,800 pounds, and the 0 to 60 time is somewhere in the 5.5 to 6 second range for most models. That's not blisteringly quick, but this car has never been about straight line performance. That's always been secondary to its handling. This car is seriously quick around a track, given it only has 240 horsepower. And it's seriously fun. Out of all the cars I've tracked, this is still one of the best handling, most well-balanced cars from the factory. It's true that there are some very compelling alternatives for around the same money, around 20 to 25 grand. For example, you could pick up a pretty clean E46 M3, which has about 100 extra horsepower. It's still rear-wheel drive with a limited slip diff, and it's a riot to drive on the track. I've driven one, in fact. If you want even more power, you can pick up something like a C6 Corvette for around 20 to 25 grand with 400 plus horsepower, or even something like a 987.1 Porsche Cayman, which is exactly the car that I bought to replace my S2000. And all of these cars have their pros and cons compared to the S2000. All of them have more power. They're arguably a little easier to drive at the limit, but at the end of the day, there's something about the S2000. It just has that secret sauce. The way it handles, the way the motor revs, the way the shifter feels, it's just It's just so unique, and none of those other cars can quite match that experience. I've driven all three of those cars that I just mentioned on a racetrack before, and they're all plenty fun in their own way, but at the end of the day, I just keep coming back to this car. But here's maybe even a more important point about the S2000 compared to those other cars. If you buy an S2000 now, it's pretty apparent that the values will more than likely appreciate for the foreseeable future. Whereas those other three cars, the C6 Corvette, the E46 M3, and the original Porsche Cayman, are still depreciating assets. Granted, they are depreciating very, very slowly and are probably going to start turning around here in the next few years. My opinion is they simply don't have as much upside as the S2000. Another thing that steers some people away from the S2000 is that if they can only have one car, the S2000 isn't exactly known for being the best daily driver. And while overall I do agree with that sentiment, driving this example right now, my friend Chris's 07, is almost starting to prove that point wrong. I mean, this car might be the most comfortable S2000 I've ever driven. Being an 07, it falls into the 06 Plus category of AP2 models. It's a little bit more refined than previous model years for various little reasons. I won't go into that into this video. And on top of that, this thing's equipped with the Saki Bomb Garage Olins with the long stroke rear dampers and with a pretty mild spring rate of 12K front, 11K rear. This thing actually rides really, really well. I still wouldn't recommend this as a daily driver just because, you know, it's doesn't have a lot of storage space. It's only got two seats. Unless you spend a good amount on suspension, it's not going to be the best riding car in the world. The stereo is pretty awful. There's not a whole lot of creature comforts in the car. I mean, you get the point. These cars are also a pretty big theft magnet. I've seen many soft tops slash before. In fact, one of my first S2000s had its soft top slash right in front of my house. But if you can garage one of these things and have it as your weekend car or your track car, by all means, I do really think this is one of the absolute best cars you can buy for 20 to 25 grand. Now, personally, I am not a collector and I never plan to be. That's just not how I treat cars. So I would never go for a super minty bone stock, low mileage example that commands, you know, $40,000+. At that price range, it's no longer a car. You can't even drive it. Every mile you put on it, the car is going down in value. I mean, what's the point? So I think the sweet spot for S2000s right now, budget-wise, is if you have a budget of around 20 grand. That'll get you a car with well under 100,000 miles, typically. And it gives you options to choose between AP1 and AP2 models. A lot of people have very strong opinions that the AP2 is the better overall car, whereas the AP1 is the true S2000 with a 9K redline. I've done videos on that before, so I won't go into that. I think both cars have their pros and cons. But the point is, at 20 grand in the year 2020, you can pick up a super nice AP1 or a pretty moderately nice AP2. If you're in the market for one and you've never driven an S2000, I would say go test drive one of each. Go test drive an AP1, go test drive an 04 to 05 AP2, and then try the 06 plus AP2. For me personally, bone stock, I would like an 04 to 05. It has better throttle response than the 06 plus, and it still gives you the AP2 motor, a little bit more torque than the AP1, and it's a little bit more refined than the AP1. So I think it's a sweet spot if you're keeping your car bone stock. I'd like to know what you guys think. Is the S2000 worth purchasing in the year 2020, considering the market right now, even despite everything that's going on in the world? The market's pretty red hot, and any well-priced S2000 on the market typically doesn't stay on the market for very long. Sup?
Really?
You like my new car?
How many other colors are they making? Are you gonna buy them all?
They made like at least 9 or 10 colors.
So you're about a third of the way there.
Yeah, about a third of the way there.
Look at those brake sets, man. That's a little squeaky.
No, man, racing brakes. That's the way they sound.
I'm surprised you went with a soft top.
We'll see about that. I might have a hard top in store for this thing. P.S. It's not mine. My roommates have seen probably like 8 or 9 different S2000s at my house at this point over the last 6 or 7 years. It's just a matter of time before I get another one, guys. Don't worry. I know a lot of... I think I tricked a lot of you guys with my Instagram post today. The comments just keep flowing in saying like, oh my God, welcome back to the S2000 family. Not yet, but we may be getting close. We may be getting very close. So I hope you enjoyed the video, guys. If you have any questions or comments, if you want to prove me wrong and show me why the S2000 really isn't that great of a buy, let's get some flame wars going. I've got nothing better to do, so have at it, and I'll see you guys next time.